Paul Ramirez Jonas is a person who is known to open engagement audiences. He is a public artist who has been amongst the many artists, many of them gathered here for open engagement, who has opened up and undone the concept and practice of what perhaps public, publicly engaged art might be, socially engaged art might be. I think of him as an artist for whom cross-sector collaboration is a kind of material. He is constantly challenging cities and systems inside the material of his art practice in all varieties of projects from We Make the Treasure, Not the New, Momo Copy Shop, or big projects, big and small projects such as Taylor Square or Keys to the City, a template that he has reproduced in a number of cities, including New York, where he is imagining art projects as processes, as social processes that provoke us to rethink our public infrastructures in all new ways and reconnect us, I think, often to a sense of what it is to be a citizen. So I'm absolutely thrilled that he is here to inspire us further and to help continue to launch the open engagement discussion and conclude today's discussion for us here at Cross Sector. Paul.
Thank you, Shannon. All right, how do I start? In his short book about Proust, Beckett comments that a man with impeccable memory can't remember anything. Beckett, reading Proust, puts forward that only involuntary memory can be counted as an act of remembrance, and that perfect memory is nothing but the retrieval of stored information. Beckett wrote, "The man with good memory does not remember anything because he does not forget anything." It is in this notion of memory that I would like to position this talk of public art. I used the term public art merely as a placeholder. I could have said monument or memorial or social sculpture or social practice or socially engaged art. These terms describe some, but not all, of the aspects of what I want to discuss. Both halves of the compound word public art are complex. And it's peculiar that when we co-join them, they result in such a stale meaning. Put together, these two open-ended ideas seem diminished. The image that the word public art conjures is of unimaginative statues, decorative murals, street furniture plastered with tiles, abstract forms surrounded by expanses of well-kept grass, triumphal arches ringed by roundabouts, bronze likenesses of people we do not remember, generic obelisks that repeat a form without question, lions guarding the steps of institutions, plaques mounted on boulders, and even more recent inventions such as artists' images on billboards. Creating a little space between the two words with the insertion of "and" brings out the potential between them, art and public, or switching it around, public and art. Jean-Luc Godard said, "It takes two to make an image." I would take the liberty of reading this quote as, "It takes two to make an artwork." These are the three variables in this equation: an artist, a viewer, and the image between them. The variables can be assigned different values as long as the relationship between them and the equivalence of the formula is not altered. Thus, author, text, reader, or performer, scored, listener, or actor, play, spectator, can all be plugged into the formula, "It takes two to make an image." And accepting this flexibility allows us to reshape hierarchies that value one of the elements over the other. This reevaluation suggests that we can dissolve the conflict of who has more value, artist, artwork, or viewer, by tying the three together as essential parts of a whole. Accepting this means accepting that the artwork is contingent and its meaning exists only as a relationship that is always changing. How does this affect our understanding of what we call public art? In this compound word, public usually refers to a kind of space, such as public versus private. It can also refer to a kind of recipient, such as the group versus an individual. And sometimes it means something about the ownership. It belongs to all rather than to one. But the public almost never means an active maker. The public, what is it? Is it just a group of people? Is it just a kind of space? Or is it, as Godard suggested, people making something like an image? How does it gather? Can it exist prior to the thing it gathers for? Is it always present, waiting for text, sounds, or images to read? Or is it coming together, make the thing it's coming together for appear? How passive can it be and still be a public? And since it takes two, does the image require a simultaneous presence of author and public? Is a public concert a concert without attendance? And is a novel without readers? How many viewers need to be present? Is one enough? Are 10, 100, 100,000? Can there be too many? Are all forms of art public art? Always? And how long does a public last? And what becomes of the artwork after the public dissolves? The German philosopher Jürgen Habermas stated that a portion of the public sphere comes into being in every conversation in which private individuals assemble to form a public body. They then behave neither like a business or professional people transacting private affairs, nor like members of a constitutional order subject to the legal constraints of a state bureaucracy. Citizens behave as a public body when they confer in an unrestricted fashion, that is, with the guarantee of freedom of assembly and association, and the freedom to express and publish their opinions about matters of general interest. Consider this alongside It Takes Two to Make an Image. It greatly expands how we can understand art and its public. At one end, we have an author, authoring. In the middle, we have the artwork made public. And at the other end, in Habermas's words, we have private individuals assembled to form a public body. All the parts are present and the making is complete. As I sat on my desk working on this talk, the Beatles sang into my ears. I know you, you know me. One thing I can tell you is you've got to be free. Come together right now over me. I was a private individual listening to this song, and I was part of a public body as long as others somewhere, out loud or in their minds, were humming the melody. We temporarily formed a chorus. I was singing, come together. Even the mention of this song makes you sing, come together. And we are singing, come together. We came together as a public body just by listening or playing it in our minds. It is not even necessary to be in the same room, but we could as we are now. All the theater people attending a play also form a public body. In his 1966 play, Offending the Audience, Peter Handke addresses the public in this way. You are sitting in rows. You form a pattern. You are sitting in a certain order. You are facing in a certain direction. You are sitting equidistant from one another. You are an audience. You form a unit. You are auditors and spectators in an auditorium. Your thoughts are free. You can still make up your own minds. You see us speaking and you hear us speaking. You are beginning to breathe in one and the same rhythm. You are beginning to breathe in one and the same rhythm in which we are speaking. You're breathing the way we are speaking. We and you gradually form a unit. According to Habermas, publics are self-organized. They come together on their own accord and they confer in an unrestricted fashion about matters of general interest. Habermas does not put any restriction on what the public should be conferring about, and certainly art could do. And with this assertion, we fall into a chicken and egg casualty dilemma. Artworks are made for the public, and made by the public all at once. In his essay, Publics and Counterpublics, Michael Warner thoroughly discusses the implications of Habermas's public sphere vis-a-vis texts. He writes, the public is a kind of social totality. Its most common sense is that of the people in general. It might be the people organized as the nation, the commonwealth, the city, the state, or some other community. It might be very general, as in Christendom or humanity. He goes on to describe a second kind of public. A public can also be a second thing, a concrete audience, a crowd witnessing itself in visible space, as with a theatrical public. A in such a public also has a sense of totality, bounded by the events or by the shared physical space. A performer on stage knows where her public is, how big it is, where its boundaries are, and what the time of its common existence is. A crowd at a sports event or a concert or a riot might be a bit blurrier around the edges, but still knows itself by knowing where and when it is assembled in common visibility and common action. And finally, a third kind of public, the kind of public that comes into being only in relation to texts and their circulation. The first public Warner describes is the public more often addressed by public art, the people, humanity, my fellow Americans. Addressing this totality is the innocent mistake of the beginner, who unquestioningly believes in universality. It is also the cynical manipulation of the fascist that tries to reduce us all into all-encompassing identities. It also leads down the road of the lowest common denominator, so common in public art. The second public described by Warner is reassuring in its concreteness. This public awaits the artist that engages in performance or social practice, or any form where the artist and public coexist in a defined space for a determined amount of time. And this second public is rewarding. The artist knows who they are talking to and can make the work specifically for them. But the third type of public that Warner is attempting to clarify concerns me the most. While many of the strategies of innovative public art are geared towards a second type of public, we always crave the third public. And the circulation this public needs returns us back to the arms of some kind of permanent form. The artists from the 60s and 70s who developed performance art, happening, social sculpture, and other ephemeral forms also had to contend with this challenge. And they re-embraced permanence through documentation and the relic. But in the ensuing decades, these forms have slowly drifted back to a form of address that treats the public as a kind of social totality of the first public. This is our current challenge. How does a new kind of public art address this third public without reverting to the first kind of public? There is no question that we need the third public that is neither bound by the duration of a performance, nor shaped by the architecture of the space, nor defined by group identity. It is my intuition that this type of public is the one that can fully blur the line between reader and author. This is the public that we have been promised when Jorge Luis Borges said that the reader is as if or not more creative than the author. And Joseph Beuys joined in with everyone's an artist. And Roland Barthes spared no punches saying that the death of the author is the birth of the reader. And Jean-Luc Godard added, it takes two to make an image. And Paulo Freire added, there should be student teachers and teacher students. And Hillary Clinton said, it takes a village. But it is not so simple. Even a small watercolor of flowers seen by a few art lovers is public art, for it can have a public in the full Habermasian sense of the word. And being in public makes the watercolor. It makes it in the sense that Jorge Luis Borges elucidated in this quote, the fact is that poetry is not the books in the library. Poetry is the encounter of the reader with the book. Admittedly, this reasoning dilutes the meaning of public art to any artwork with a public. And if all art is public art, this talk needs a new term. Otherwise, it becomes an essay about art, and I do not have the interest to undertake such a venture. So, for as long as it's useful, I will use a subcategory of public art, the monument. Monument's primary function is memory. The word is defined as monumentum, commemorative statue or building, tomb, reminder, written record, literary work. The Latin root is monere, which means to warn, as in do not repeat our mistakes. It could be said that their subject matter is memory of an improving and purposeful kind. And unlike art, monuments always assume a public, and they are placed in spaces accessible to their intended public. I don't even think we consider monuments to be monuments if they are removed from their assigned spaces. Collective monuments are placed in common spaces accessible to all, while private monuments, such as gravestones, need only be accessible to family and friends. In keeping with the blurring of reader and writer, the monument's public often seems as important as their author. They are not made for the primary purpose of self-expression by the author, although self-expression is possible. Instead, it is hoped that they will transcend the aesthetics of their time and the fame of their author. It is their message for a public that is supposed to endure the ages. Indeed, something that functions a lot like a monument is the only kind of art that Plato was willing to admit into the Republic when he wrote, "We must remain firm in our conviction that hymns to the gods and praises of famous men are the only poetry which ought to be admitted into our state." Monuments are simultaneously a language we use to communicate with the future and a vehicle for remembrance, although not the remembrance that Marcel Proust wrote about. Samuel Beckett, in reading Proust, said that voluntary memory, and I quote, "is of no value as an instrument of evocation and provides an image as far removed from the real as the myth of our imagination or the caricature furnished by direct perception. The only real expression and one adequate mode of evocation, over neither we have the least control." But through monuments, we attempt to control evocation. It is through them that we try to turn our present into a permanent past. From the Sumerians, Egyptians, Greeks, to our United States, we keep entrusting our message of for the future in the durability of stone and metal. These attempts betray an underlying anxiety, for surely, if the battle of X or civic personage Y or Monday morning Z were so crucial to the future, our descendants would not need bronze and marble to remember them by. If X, Y, and Z were truly essential, they would remain in conversation and their presence would be guaranteed. And yet, as I walk around the cityscape and stare at hundreds of monuments, I find myself unable to remember what any of them are about. They're more likely to evoke an involuntary memory than to conjure up the intended remembrance. The monuments are more in line with Proust than Plato. So after this long introduction, I would like to introduce a number of monuments. I will begin by visiting the USS Maine National Monument in Central Park in New York. The monument faces west, and the nearly horizontal rays of the setting sun were caught in the gold leaf of the statue. This was the time when the monument looks at its best. It was getting too dark for the tourists, and it was time to start looking for a restaurant. The locals would soon get out of work and hurry home. I leaned my bike on the steps of the base and took a seat. I came here to experience the involuntary memories that Proust values, in contrast to the voluntary memories that the stone and bronze structure behind me sought to evoke. Three people were sitting on the steps with me, and each person was alone with their backs to the monument. A pedicab drove by, and pointing at the structure, the driver, who also doubled as a tourist guide, explained at the monument to the couple sitting on the passenger seat. They drifted out of earshot before I was able to make out his explanation. The stone explained itself to the valiant seaman who perished in the Maine. A man with sneakers approached the steps. He was talking on the phone, and I heard him say, "I'm in front of the statue with gold leaf." He climbed the steps and looked out like a sentry. He saw a woman he had been waiting for in the crowd below. At that moment, I noticed that the woman to my right was also scanning the crowds as they were walking around Columbus Circle. Two girls joined me. They were using the steps as a picnic area. I smelled the food while my eyes read on the stone, "By fate unwarned, in death unafraid." Nearby, a souvenir seller sold framed pictures of New York City's landmarks, the Statue of Liberty with fireworks, the World Trade Center intact, the American flag waving in the air, the American eagle soaring in a perfect blue sky, Central Park covered in snow, John Lennon shot dead a few blocks from here, an out-of-place and long-dead Bob Marley, and next to him, a recently famous Justin Bieber. The date in the stone read, 1898 to 1912. The makeshift souvenir store was the only conceivable place where one could expect to find a souvenir of the USS Maine, but none were available. To my right, a woman who had been waiting was finally met by her two companions. And next to them, a young man spoke on his mobile phone as he simultaneously took pictures of an older woman posing in front of the monument. Judging from the distance and composition of the picture, I could tell that the monument was not really the subject of this picture. The memorial seemed incidental to the intentions of this photographer. It was just backdrop. They did not notice that it included this inscription: "Erected through public subscription by the National Maine Monument Committee, James Grant Wilson, Chairman, William Hurst, George Schrady, John Keller, and Edward Simmons." More people were now eating on sitting. The monument seemed transformed into a plein air cafeteria. They used the monument as a chair, but faced away from the sculpted figures and the bronze plaques with the informative words. And I realized they were looking away from the monument itself. And this functionality was not intended, but it was built into the design of the structure. Their eyes were not directed towards the words Harold Van Buren, architect, or Attilio Piccinini, sculptor. It would seem that the form of the USS Maine Memorial is made so we will avert our gaze from the tragedy it memorializes. The steps of a Greek theater, on the other hand, use similar materials and forms, yet are designed to focus our attention of each sitter towards the tragedy. The drivers idled around those steps, waiting for more passengers. Ladies, would you like a bike ride today? The tourists ignored the query from the driver, and they also ignored the monument telling them to the freemen who died in the war with Spain that others might be free. Two people arrived with that seemed to be interested. They looked at the monument through the screen of their camera and took a picture, but they immediately turned and also took a picture of the new shopping mall across Columbus Circle. And immediately after that, they turned and took a quick picture of the globe at the center of Columbus Circle. They panned a complete 360 degrees and satisfied that every landmark within their sight was stored in their camera's memory card, they quickly walked away. Perhaps if their camera had enough high resolution and if for some improbable reason they ever zoomed into one of the captured images, they might be able to read. In memoriam, USS Maine. Destroyed in Havana Harbor, February 15, 1898, this tablet is cast from metal recovered from the USS Maine. The man who had been sitting next to me sipping a coffee since I arrived was recruited to take a portrait of a couple, and behind them a very small plaque read, "Illumination provided in memory of E. Barclay Osborne by his lovely wife, Gloria, 1983. By now, I had witnessed the full range of public engagement for this monument. Monument as bench, monument as dining area, monument as meeting point, monument as phone booth, monument as photo backdrop, monument as smoking lounge, monument as lookout point, monument as stretching aid for joggers. And none of these uses of the monument commemorated the dead sailors listed on its flank. Jenkins Friend W., Lieutenant. Merritt Darwin R., Assistant Engineer. Adams John T., Co-Passer. Aitkins James P., Boatswain. It would take me 10 minutes to read the names of all 184 dead. What did I remember through this monument? And what do I remember in front of any monument? What was the difference between the intended memories addressed to me across 100 years and the evocations that the form inspired? How did I co-create the meaning of the monument? And how was I just spoken to? Beckett would say that, I quote, "He cannot remember yesterday any more than he can remember tomorrow." I was made to learn about the USS Maine in high school, and later I voluntarily researched it for an art project. I remember making life-size drawings of its propellers and building a scale model of the ship. Recently, I witnessed the public sitting and milling around the memorial. The monument also triggered a memory of reading the book that Beckett wrote about Proust. I had countless thoughts, feelings, and memories that I could not neatly package into this text, but that I experienced while spending time with the USS Maine monument that did not seem particularly well calibrated for this by its makers. I was perhaps the only sympathetic viewer that the monument had that day, and still, it managed to invoke as many involuntary associations as it did the particulars it was designed for. Still, the monument survives as a public presence. It is a landmark in spite of the public ignoring its original primary purpose. Its historic nature somewhat protects the public space from development and privatization. Somehow, this dynamic secures the space for visitors, who rather than look at the monument, give their backs to it. And in doing so, they took look out in exactly the direction of the monument figure three looks out. Their gaze is in alignment with the address of the masonry. Their gaze is in alignment with the amnesia that the monument inadvertently promotes. The next monument I want to discuss is one of the most moving and effective monuments I have ever seen. Unlike the USS Maine National Memorial, it performs its commemorative function quite effectively. I came upon it unwittingly on my way to visit Mount Rushmore. imperfect and inaccurate, this is my memory of it. The Monument of Crazy Horse is located a few miles from Mount Rushmore and starts in conceptual and geographical opposition to it. Mount Rushmore was carved out of the Black Hills of North or South Dakota. These hills are sacred land belonging to a treaty to a Native American tribe. Nevertheless, as part of the American Indians' long history of broken promises, the Black Hills were taken from them by the United States government. And I think I remember that they took the fight all the way to the Supreme Court. The United States government carved one of their sacred hills with a bust of four prominent American presidents, Lincoln, Roosevelt, Washington, and the other one. After the sculpture was completed, a Native American chief, and I should recall his name, wrote a letter to the assistant to the main sculptor of Mount Rushmore. At the time, the young Polish artist lived in Greenpoint, Brooklyn, and the letter asked if the young sculptor would come back to the Black Hills and this time carve a Native American hero into one of the hills. Improbably as it may seem, the young sculptor agreed, and from then on he dedicated his entire life to the project. While Mount Rushmore was made quickly, with many resources and full government support, the Monument to Crazy Horse was for many years the effort of a single artist living in a tent out in the wilderness with a few resources donated by a very small community. The project remains unfinished to this day. It is now being carved by the children of the artist, and the project only accepts individual donations for its funding. Twice in its history has this enterprise refused offers from the federal government to pay for the entire thing. When I visited the memorial, I was made aware that this would be a long, multi-generational, and probably interminable project. The project is like a mathematical limit, ever approaching completion, but never achieving it. I found the coup de grace against its neighbor at the end of my visit. Upon exiting, I passed a mound of rubble made from the carved up portions of the giant statue. The pile of material is quite literally the negative space of the sculpture. A sign invites visitors to take a piece of stone as a souvenir, and I took one. Everything about this counter monument borders on being symmetrically structured fairy tale, pitting Mount Rushmore against Crazy Horse. The master carved Mount Rushmore, while the apprentice carved Crazy Horse. Tourists leave Mount Rushmore with a pewter reproduction made in China, while visitors leave Crazy Horse with a natural piece of the Black Hills. Mount Rushmore souvenir is representational. Crazy Horse's souvenir is abstract. Mount Rushmore was initiated and funded by a government, Crazy Horse by self-organized individuals. Mount Rushmore speaks through presence, Crazy Horse through absence. In the Crazy Horse Memorial, the weak voice embraces its strengths. And the memorial endures because it is a constant process of becoming. It is closer to a long durational performance than an object. I wanted to compare my memory to an entry taken directly from Wikipedia. Wikipedia shares some similarities with the Crazy Horse Monument. Both are alternatives to the traditional monument. One of their similarities is lack of fixity. Wikipedia entries have no single or final author, thus the entries are in a constant state of flux, yet at any one moment they fully exist as an encyclopedia entry. They occupy a space. Likewise, the Crazy Horse Memorial is in a state of flux, but it does exist, and it offers each visitor a concrete form. They both hold form and defy permanence simultaneously. The collective memory of Wikipedia corrected my faulty memory. It said, "The Crazy Horse Memorial is a mountain monument in the Black Hills of South Dakota in the form of Crazy Horse, an Oglala Lakota warrior riding a horse, and it is roughly 8 miles away from Mount Rushmore. The sculpture's final dimensions will be, etc. And the monument has been in progress since 1948 and is still far from completion. If finished, it will be the world's largest sculpture. The mountain carving was begun in 1948 by sculptor Korzak Zalkowski, who was worked with Mount Rushmore under Goodson Borglum. In 1939, Zalkowski had received a letter from Chief Henry Standing Bear, which stated in part, "My fellow chiefs and I would like the white man to know that the red man has great heroes too." As a nonprofit undertaking, the memorial received no federal or state funding. Zalkowski was offered $10 million from the federal government on two occasions, but he turned the offers down. Zalkowski felt the project was more than just the mountain carving, and he feared that his plans for the broader educational as well as cultural goals of the memorial would be left behind with federal involvement. Zalkowski died in 1982.
Filkowski's wife, Ruth, and several of his children remained closely involved in the work, which was no fixed completion date. The face of Crazy Horse was completed, While Lakota chief Henry Standing Bear believed the motives may have been sincere, many traditional Lakota and Native Americans opposed this memorial. On. In 1972 autobiography, Lame Deer, a Lakota medicine man, remarked, "The whole idea of making a beautiful wild mountain into a statue of him is a pollution of the landscape. It is against the spirit of Crazy Horse." To this day, the memorial remains controversial with the Native American community. Neither the Wikipedia entry nor any literature I could find confirms the existence of one of the most innovative aspects of the memorial, the rubble's availability as a souvenir. I encountered the third monument at a cocktail party, I think. I was having a conversation with Tom Finkelpearl. Back then, he was the director of the Queens Museum. And Tom always likes to surprise me with a good story. And that evening, he told me that when it was being decided what to build as the Washington Monument, someone proposed that the monument should be a giant chalkboard where the people could scribble whatever they wanted. My memory is fuzzy, but it was possible but was it possible that as people fill the blackboards, more boards would be added? And did I imagine that it would slowly become anomalous? I decided to call him. "Hey, Tom, how are you? Is it okay if I record you?" "Tom?" "Yes, no problem. Thanks for taking my call. I'm just trying to write this text, and one of the things I'm doing is thinking about involuntary memory versus the retrieval of information." "I keep thinking about the memorial and monuments and how they're usually made with a very specific memory in mind." "And they are trying to communicate to the future, and I'm comparing that versus the involuntary memory that actually comes from monuments. I'm making a list of my favorite monuments and what memories were elicited from them. Now I have to compare my memories to the facts. One of my favorite memorials is something I learned about through a conversation you and I had." "Now I'm comparing my memory to the facts by calling you." "This could also be based on a natural memory by me." "Yes, it could be like a rabbit hole we fall through. I am well known for having the basic facts sometimes generally correct and the specifics not so. So what in particular?" "At some point at the party, you were telling me that when it was being decided what to build at the site of the Washington Monument, one of the proposals was this, it gets fuzzy, some kind of chalkboard." "Yes. Sometimes I remember that the entire obelisk was going to be made of chalkboard, and at other times I remember that the chalkboard would keep going down to the ground, so that as more people wrote, the monument would be pushed into the ground." "Those are two different ones. There's a chalkboard one, and there's one going into the ground." "Oh, so there were two different proposals?" "One of them was built, and the other one was a proposal. One of them was for the Washington Monument, and one was not. It must have been the same conversation." "It was the same conversation. So the two memories. One monument under discussion was a project that Joachim Goertz made in Germany, in a suburb of Hamburg called Harburg. It was a Holocaust memorial, and it was sort of a, not an obelisk, it was a big vertical tower coated with lead. So then there were all these little styluses, and you could etch into the lead some kind of comment about the Holocaust." "Oh, right, that was it." "And then, every several months or whatever it was, they lowered the monument. They lowered it into a parking garage, as I seem to remember. And when it went down, different parts of what were etched into this monument were visible at different levels of the garage, so that you had a disappearing monument that gradually sank into the ground. Not into the ground, but into the parking garage. That was a completed monument. It had nothing to do with the Washington Monument." "Are you sure you're not mixing it with Sunken Kilometer by Walter de Maria?" "I'm not sure, but I'm pretty sure. If you Google Joachim Goertz, G-E-R-Z, it is in Harburg, H-A-R-B-U-R-G. I have it in a catalog. I can check that at home. I'm fairly certain that that's what it is." "Yes, could you check it, please, when you get home?" "Indeed. So there's the one, and then there's the Washington Monument." "Okay. So there was this long debate about the Washington Monument, and there were people who wanted to make it into a kingly monument about George Washington. You know, there were people that actually wanted America to be more like a monarchy, and there were people who wanted to be democratic. There is an essay, so it can be checked, and I can tell you where this essay is." "Oh, no, please don't worry about it. A congressman got up in D.C. and proposed that instead of a fixed monument, there should be chalkboards on which people could write their feelings about George Washington. And those could be periodically erased, and there would be people's monument. I've always felt that if this, I think it was in the 1930s, or maybe the early 19th century, or maybe, no, it must have been the 19th century. If that happened, I think that we would have set public art ahead at least 100 years. Can you imagine 19th century George Washington monument with a bunch of chalkboards upon which people can write stuff that then gets erased? Yes, I can, but then I would be out of business. Right. I can tell you when, I can also tell you when you can check that. Well, it's interesting because I'm actually going to Lower Manhattan to where the protesters are, and I was hanging out with them and I noticed that they were using the big red modernist sculpture. I don't know who made it. It's a Mark de Subero. Right, it's a Mark de Subero, and they're taping notes to it. It's back to the same thing that keeps coming back in our conversations, the monument that gets reinscribed in some way. Yeah. Well, okay, Tom, thanks, goodbye. The big red sculpture is actually titled Joie de Vivre, and it is the fourth monument I want to discuss. The sculpture stands on the corner of a plaza named after the CEO of the corporation that now manages it. It is a public space which has a history that reveals the devolution of many of our commons into corporate hands. United States Steel created the plaza in 1968 in exchange for the rights to build a taller than allowed office tower. At the time, it was given the name Liberty Square. Even with its privately funded origin, it was held in public trust by the city. United States Steel did not own it, regulate it, or manage it. The square was built again as a result of damage incurred during the September 11, 2001 attack on the World Trade Center. This was done with private corporate money, and it was renamed Zuccotti Park after John Zuccotti. Zuccotti had been a public servant working as the City Planning Commission chairman for the city, and after retiring from public office, he became CEO of a real estate development corporation, the very same corporation that provided the funds for the rebuilding of Liberty Square. From Liberty to Zuccotti, this is the nature of much of our public space. Why is land held in public trust handed over to corporation? Zuccotti Park is a civic no man's land, and yet it remains a potential gathering place, where ironically citizens have fewer restrictions on the rights of assembly than a proper park. New York City parks all have curfews. Meanwhile, as part of the transfer of Liberty Square to the corporation, the state demanded 24-hour public access to the park. And with this change, Zuccotti Park became one of the rare public spaces in the city without a curfew. It is in this vague terrain that Occupy Wall Street landed in 2011. Luck placed the protesters in one of the few parcels of land where continuous protests could take place without breaking the law. Most organizational meetings were taking place in the space underneath Joie de Vivre, and with the help of some tape and some handmade signs, the steel beams of the sculpture became bulletin boards. The Blackboard Washington monument that was only proposed was inadvertently built. And as the days passed, the meaning of Joie de Vivre began to change. In the urban space, the sculpture was a placeholder for art, a monument to nothing but its own form. And true to its modernist roots, it referenced nothing about the site itself, or about its history, or about the local geography. It was an autonomous sculpture. But the price to pay for such autonomy was that it was also stood for nothing. It was not absurd to fantasize that someday Joie de Vivre would become the symbol of Occupy Wall Street. If the protesters succeeded, would any of us be surprised if in a hopeful future a veteran activist rolled up her sleeve to reveal a tattoo of Joie de Vivre? Her tattoo would mirror the proliferation of USS Maine tattoos more than a century ago, when sailors would tattoo images of their ship along with the slogan, "Remember the Maine." Both our past sailors and our protesters from the future would show us their arms as if to say, "I was there, I was part of it." Like the sinking of the ship, the protest around Joie de Vivre could conceivably change the meaning intended by its author. Already, the tall sculpture was becoming a marker for a site of protest. But hasn't this process of transformation happened many times before? Haven't monuments built to embody specific messages been changed through public action? Bronze, stone, and steel are only capable of a single inscription. Once carved or cast, the words and images cannot be changed. But as readers, we may choose to read them in any way we want. It takes two to make an image. The meaning of the monument is not only up to its author. A city ordinance prohibited the protesters from amplifying sound, and this limited their ability to conduct town meetings or deliver speeches. But they did circumvent this limit through something called a human microphone. Anyone who had something to say could simply stand up and yell, "Mic check!" Whomever was within earshot then repeated, "Mic check!" in a loud voice and in a direction away from the speaker. The echo spread in concentric ripples until it reached all assembled. The day after my first visit to the park, Zizek showed up, and at one point he warned of the dangers inherent in memorializing history. There is a danger. Don't fall in love with yourselves. We have a nice time here. But remember, carnivals come cheap.
What matters is the day after.
What matters is the day after.
When we will have to return to normal life.
When we will have to return to normal life.
Will there be any changes then?
Will there be any changes then?
I don't want you to remember these days. You know, like, oh, we were young, it was beautiful. Remember that our basic message is.
Remember that our basic message is.
We are allowed to think about alternatives.
We are allowed to think about alternatives. Zizek, in effect, called for an anti-monumental memory. He did not want the protesters to remember these days as the glory days. He did not want these days to be portrayed as so distant or so special that the protagonist would become other than us. Perhaps he feared that the basic message, whether it was remember the main or we are allowed to think about alternatives, would end up preserved in permanent materials. He wanted the basic message to remain alive, in circulation, performed, read, discussed. In other words, it should remain public. Our bodies are impermanent, and maybe enshrining our ideals in materials alien to our ephemerality alters us from them. Zizek added,
beware not only of the enemies,
but also of false friends
who are already working to dilute this process.
Who are already working to dilute this process.
In the same way you get coffee without caffeine.
In the same way you get coffee without caffeine.
Beer without alcohol.
Beer without alcohol.
Ice cream without fat.
Ice cream without fat.
They will try to make this into a harmless moral protest.
They will try to make this into a harmless moral protest.
A decaffeinated protest.
A decaffeinated protest.
But the reason we are here.
But the reason we are here.
Is that we have enough of the world.
Is that we have enough of the world.
Where to recycle
Coke cans.
Give
a couple of dollars to charity,
or to buy a Starbucks cappuccino.
Where 1% goes to third world starving children, is enough to make us feel good. After outsourcing work and torture.
After the marriage agencies are now outsourcing
even our love life,
they After the marriage agencies are outsourcing our love life.
Mic check. Mic check.
Mic check.
Mic check. We can see that for a long time.
We allow our political engagement also to be outsourced.
political engagement also to be outsourced.
We want it back.
Was this taking back going to take place in the corporate plaza? Wasn't it ours to begin with? Who can enact this taking back? The public assembled at Zuccotti Park? Could Joie de Vivre have generated this public body? Did the protesters use the sculpture as part of the text that constituted themselves? Could any of this have happened without what we call the commons? The only sense in which we are communists is that we care for the commons.
The commons of nature.
The commons of nature.
The commons of what is privatized by intellectual property.
The commons of what is privatized by intellectual property.
The commons of biogenetics.
The commons of biogenetics.
For this and only for this we fight.
For this, and only for this, we should fight.
Communism failed absolutely.
But the problems of the commons are here.
They are telling you, we are not Americans.
They are telling you, we are not Americans here.
But the conservative fundamentalists claim they are really Americans.
But the conservative fundamentalists who claim they are really American have to be reminded of something. What is Christianity? It's the Holy Spirit.
What is the Holy Spirit?
What is the Holy Spirit?
It's an egalitarian community of believers.
Who are linked by love for each other.
And who only have their own freedom and responsibility to do it.
And who only have their own freedom and responsibility to do it.
In this sense, the Holy Spirit is here now.
The Holy Spirit is here now. At this point in my talk, I may also need to swap the term public space for the commons. The commons, like the monument, seems more precise, more descriptive than public space. Its archaic ring warns us that it's a kind of space that we may be fading from memory. The takeover of Zuccotti Park and the change in meaning of Joie de Vivre is not a new phenomenon. Legitimate or not, the state inscribed our public spaces with inscriptions, such as historic dates, prominent names, lists of the dead, mottos, assurances, and in rare instances, a list of our universal rights. Article 1. Men are born and remain free and equal in rights. Social distinctions may be founded only upon the general good. Stone and metal are the materials of a public voice that pursues stability. In a representative government, the public voice should be represent us. And in a non-democratic government, the public voice is not ours. In either case, the material of the public voice are not like our individual voices. Our voices are impermanent. They can only be heard when they are being used. Article 11 of our universal rights. The free communication of ideas and opinions is one of the most precious of the rights of man. Every citizen may, accordingly, speak, write, and print with freedom, but shall be responsible for such abuses of this freedom as shall be defined by law. Can we as individuals change the permanent inscriptions of the state without resorting to vandalism or destruction? One stone and bronze take a form and a meaning, can we change them? Can we merely choose to read the text different? Can we simply use the form differently? Can we treat them as scores and interpret them in our own way? We can perform the monument. In 2011, the citizens of Bahrain did just that when they took over the fifth monument under consideration in this talk. Pearl Square is the capital city of Manama. This monument would not be out of place in a city here in this country. Its full name is the Roundabout of the Pearl. It is a circular expanse of grass bound by a highly trafficked road with a sculpture at its center. The iconic monument serves as the logo of the city. I can imagine buying a postcard of this kind as a proof that I have been to Manama. The The monument's capacity to represent the city, is, if not the country itself, is illustrated by its use in their national currency. The images I have seen of the roundabout of the Pearl show the public space free of people. To go there, one would have to brave several lanes of traffic that drain the space. And once there, one would find no benches, or playground, or sports facilities, or bathrooms. It is a public space that seems designed to repel the public. And despite its unwelcoming design, from February 14th to March 13th of 2011, the citizens of Bahrain used the space to demand more rights. They wanted to be represented by their government, and eventually their government expelled them from the commons. What to do with these expulsions in Manama or New York? What do they do to the space? Can it still be called public space? Despite of this, protesters achieved something remarkable. The Pearl Monument once represented the government and the nation, now it represented them and their demands. The seven salt-like pillars no longer represented the seven Gulf states, and the sphere that the pillars supported no longer represented a pearl. The sculptural form had acquired a new meaning, and in this story, the reader does have the power to change the text. And while the protesters' actions were ephemeral, the government deemed the change in meaning permanent, absolutely permanent. Therefore, it was left with no option but to erase their inscription from the public space. And on March 18th of 2011, the government itself demolished it. The writer Hakim Bey describes the possibilities that a temporary moment of autonomy can bring about. He calls these moments temporary autonomous zones, and he wrote, "The TAZ is like an uprising which does not engage directly with the state, a guerrilla operation which liberates an area of land, of time, of imagination, and then dissolves itself to reform elsewhere, before the state can crush it. Because the state is concerned primarily with simulation rather than substance, the TAZ can occupy these areas clandestinely and carry on its peaceful purposes for quite a while in relative peace." A temporary performance can be a very strong material. In a recent public talk, linguist Steven Pinker used a demonstration to explain the difference between individual and mutual knowledge. In his example, citizens of a fictitious country are opposed to the dictator. To avoid persecution, they expressed their dissatisfaction to each other at home or in small groups, and they insinuated their views through indirect language. This created individual knowledge of their dislike of the government. They knew that they knew, but they did not know that the other persons knew that they knew. However, when the citizens congregated in a public space and demonstrated against the dictator together, they used explicit language. They were no longer protecting themselves with innuendo or euphemisms or ambiguity. They made their opposition public and visible to each other, and in doing so, they created mutual knowledge. They knew that they knew that the other person knew, and they knew that the other persons knew that they knew. Pinker's example explains the power of freedom of assembly, and it implies the crucial necessity of an actual space for this assembly. We need to keep in mind that we might still require a commons made of physical space. And this is where a second public can exist, bound by time and space. The area of the TAZ can be of land, of time, but also of imagination. The TAZ of the imagination requires a form that can circulate and create the elusive third kind of public that Michael Warner described. The Bahraini protesters changed the text to performance, and in turn, the state changed their reinterpreted monument to destruction. I have hinted that there are possible formal solutions to such materials that are always capable of new inscriptions, as was proposed with the never-built Blackboard Washington Monument, or making monuments that are never finished. If we look for them, history is full of alternative strategies. So while the protesters in Zuccotti Park were reinscribing Joie de Vivre by gently taping paper signs on its surface, in the past, citizens might have chosen to topple it. Consider this petition. Inasmuch as the Vendôme column is a monument devoid of all artistic value, tending to perpetuate by its expression the ideas of war and conquest of the past imperial dynasty, which are reproved by a republican nation sentiment, citizen Courbet expresses the wish that the National Defense Government will authorize him to dismantle this column. During the brief experience of the Paris Commune, citizen and painter Gustave Courbet eventually did lead a crowd that toppled the Vendôme column. Digging further back, we find that the column was itself a result of two reinscriptions. The first occurred when hundreds of cannons belonging to the defeated Austrians and Russians who opposed Napoleon were melted into the form of the column. And the second was that the column memorialized Napoleon's victory by appropriating the form of the Trajan column in Rome, which tells the story of the victory of the Roman general Trajan over the Dacians. In our present time, the Vendôme column is the accumulation of all these transformations. It is a good example of what Michael Warner meant when he wrote, "No single text can create a public, nor can a single voice, a single genre, or even a single medium. All are insufficient to create the kind of reflexivity that we call a public, since the public is understood to be an ongoing space of encounter for discourse. It's not texts themselves that create publics, but the concatenations of texts through time. Only when a previously existing discourse can be supposed and a responding discourse be postulated can a text address a public." I grew up in Honduras, a country with more governments than years of independence. It has resulted in a multitude of fragmented histories, too many to come together as a coherent discourse. There's also a lack of historical records that makes a concatenation and layering of text nearly impossible. In my country, texts are often generated in a void, without a prior text to refer to and without the expectation of a future response. Still, it is not without some interesting monuments. In our capital stands my seventh case study, an equestrian statue of our independence hero, Francisco Morazan. After the War of Independence, Central America became a union and soon thereafter plunged into civil war. Our hero fought to protect the union, but his side lost. The union became five separate countries, and to oversimplify a complicated story, Francisco Morazan was executed by firing squad. In time, we could overlook that we had killed the father of our nation. Monies were raised and two dignitaries were sent to Paris to commission a grand statue. As often happens in Honduras, the dignitaries embezzled the money. However, rather than just stealing the money outright, these two gentlemen seemed to have had a wicked sense of humor, or perhaps they were artists ahead of their time. They bought a second-hand statue of an out-of-favor Napoleonic general and shipped it back home. And even though every Honduran knows this tale, we have mutual knowledge, the statue was nevertheless placed in our central square. As a child, I was part of my school's marching band. In every Independence Day, I marched and laid flowers at the base of the monument. I grew up around a debate regarding the veracity of these events. Some swore it was a fiction cooked up by no other than Gabriel Garcia Marquez. Others simply pointed to the altogether foreign uniform that the man on the horse was wearing and shrugged their shoulders. For me, it remains a perfect monument, unstable in meaning and posing questions rather than talking down to its public. The statue is a constant generator of debate about history, memory, and corruption, malleable and shape-shifting despite its base of stone and figure of bronze. Fearing that my memory was making things up, I emailed Eduardo Barr, director of the National Library of Honduras. As the custodian of our national archives, I hoped that he would also settle this history. Loosely translated, his email responded that it is a statue of Francisco Morazan, despite the fact that at the time, all equestrian statues resemble French General Ney. Hence the confusion. Still, it did not take much research to find well-established opinions to the opposite. As this excerpt from Gabriel Garcia Marquez's Nobel Prize acceptance lecture demonstrates, our independence from Spanish domination did not put us beyond the reach of madness. General Antonio López de Santana, three times dictator of Mexico, held a magnificent funeral for the right leg he had lost in the so-called pastry war. And General Gabriel García Moreno ruled Ecuador for 16 years as an absolute monarch. At his wake, the corpse was seated on the presidential chair, decked out in full dress uniform and a protective layer of medals. General Maximiliano Hernández Martínez, the theosophical despot of El Salvador who killed 30,000 peasants in a savage massacre, invented a pendulum to detect poison in his food, and had street lamps draped in red paper to defeat an epidemic of scarlet fever. And the statue of General Francisco Morazan, erected in the main square of Tegucigalpa, is actually one of Marshal Ney, purchased at a Paris warehouse of secondhand sculptures. The statue of Francisco Morazan has a similarity to the USS Maine National Monument. A series of step bases elevates the monument above eye level, and these steps also form natural seating areas that orient the viewer body away from the monument. Thus, their vision is turned out, creating an extroverted viewing situation. The steps are the threshold between monument and public, and they shape the public into a form. If I slice the monument in four and turn it inside out, the resulting form would make the public sit as in a theater. Their gaze would be introverted. It would be looking in. The monument and the theater do more than manifest the public. They also give rise to a distinct shape, and they organize how they stand in relation to one another. They guide the direction of the gaze, and the sum of it all can incite or suppress participation. The shape of a public sitting around a performance has ancient roots that are deeply embedded in our culture. Suppose that you and I entered a room that is full of chairs, and we have come together to watch a film, or to have a meeting, or to go to a conference. Without instruction or direction, out of an internalized agreement and knowledge of a form, we would easily arrange the chairs in a semicircle and sit facing what we have come together for. The geometry formalized by the Greeks, theater, persists almost at the level of collective body memory. Many plays from antiquity may have been lost, but not the way in which we gathered for them. The seating geometry of the theater is like a mold in which we can pour material so it can take on a meaning and shape. The shapes of the publics consist of a small repertoire of ancient resilient forms that are still persistent in our public spaces. Most seem to derive from the Greek theater. I can think of the stadium, really just a full circle to the theater's half circle, movie theaters, a rectangular version, classrooms, lecture halls, even the sofas in our living rooms form a semicircle around the entertainment center. It almost seems that when a public is arranging to that shape, something emerges similar to theater, as if it were intrinsic to the geometry. Thus, it does not seem as a coincidence that we show movies in planes and buses, since we are already sitting in formation. Minds and street performers gravitate towards the steps of a public building where people are already sitting in a natural amphitheater. There are very few formal alternatives. Parades, where the public is shaped into two parallel lines between the buildings and the street, and manifestations that are shaped by the city plan itself. And museums, where the public is shaped into a flow. It is a very small repertoire of forms that can feel very limiting. But is it any more limiting and enduring than our inherited monument forms? That repertoire is equally ancient and persistent. Our range of monuments amounts to a very limited taxonomy. We have the Sumerians, who gave us the bas relief and public buildings. The city gates bequeathed us the triumphal arch. The Egyptians left us the pyramids, the sphinx, and the obelisk. The Greeks gave us the colonnaded temple, the bust, the standing figure, and the equestrian statue. Roman engineers freed many of these structures from architecture and gave us the freestanding triumphal arch, stadia, and theaters that did not depend on the natural shape of the landscape. And somewhere in our history, we were also handed down the fountain, the guarding lions, the wall with a list of names, the column, and the reflecting pool. In total, the list hardly amounts to a baker's dozen. I simply want to highlight how conservative and constricted our public forms are. And by public form, I mean both the shape of the public and the shape of the monument. Borrowing from Nietzsche's Birth of Tragedy, I would suggest that the monument's form relation to its public is more Apollonian in character, while the theater-like shape of the public has Dionysian characteristics. Nietzsche wrote, "Through Apollo and Dionysus, the two art deities of the Greeks, we come to recognize that in the Greek world there existed a tremendous opposition in origin and aims between the Apollonian art of sculpture and the non-imagistic Dionysian art of music. These two different tendencies run parallel to each other, for the most part openly at variance, and they continually incite each other to new and more powerful births, which perpetuate an antagonism only superficially reconciled in the common term art." The limited repertoire of the monument form falls squarely on the Apollonian camp. These are forms that are seen and thought about. Only when a monument is newly dedicated might there be a display of raw emotion. The public body may participate with it by shredding tears on the stone. The metal might be pounded with angry fists, but the duration of these actions are short in relation to the longevity of the form. For the rest of its time, we will either ignore it or relate to it to reason. Some ritualistic performances can remain. We may sing Athens at its feet or lay flowers, but these performative acts hardly qualify as Dionysian. And as laid out by Nietzsche, we have higher hopes for the Dionysian arts. In song and dance, man expresses himself as a member of a higher community. He has forgotten how to walk and speak, and is on his way towards flying into the air, dancing. His very gestures express enchantment. Just as animals now walk and yield, and the earth yields milk and honey, supernatural sounds emanate from him too. He feels himself a god. He himself now walks about enchanted in ecstasy, like the gods he saw walking in his dreams. He's no longer an artist. He has become a work of art. In these paroxysms of intoxication, the artistic power of all nature reveals itself to the highest gratification of the primordial unity. The noblest clay, the most costly marble, man is here kneaded and cut, and to the sound of the chisel strokes of the Dionysian world artist rings out the cry of the Eleusinian mysteries. Do you prostrate yourself, millions? Do you sense your maker world? Well, before we have a public feeling like a god in front of a work of art, could we at least cling to the notion that the public could be artists? Everybody is an artist. It is not quite to the level of participation that the birth of tragedy describes. It is a more limited form of engagement. But can it be achieved with the public sculptural forms we have inherited? Nietzsche doesn't think so. We must keep in mind the measured restraint, that freedom from the wilder emotions, that calm of the sculptor god. Can it be achieved by the shape we give the public? At least in the semicircle of the theater and the oval of the stadium, we can see ourselves participating in the making. But neither form of the public nor the form of public art can guarantee the synthesis of reason and experience, distance and participation, looking at and being proposed by Nietzsche in Birth of Tragedy. The reconciliation of Apollo and Dionysus seems as elusive as the reconciliation of reader and writer, artist and viewer, musician and listener, teacher and student, actor and spectator. The examples I brought up in this talk point to participation and engagement as the key. The public needs to make an image, and to achieve this, we need to look beyond the public forms we have inherited. We need to look beyond public art. Why not use the full range of forms suggested by all the words in the public family? Couldn't eating in public be a public art form? It can, and it has been many times in recent history, from Gordon Matter Clark's food to Ennio Bricchettira and Aligia's cooking pieces. Couldn't public transportation become an artwork? It could. Publics have a form, and any form can be an artwork. Let's widen the repertoire. Let's make public access in public acts, in public addresses, in public Athens, in public apologies, in public banks, in public bars, in public baths, in public benches, in public bills, in public bodies, in public broadcasters, in public broadcasting, in public buildings, in public companies, in public corporations, in public defenders, in public demonstrations, in public demonstrations, in public diplomacy, in public education, in public employment, in public enemies, in public figures, in public good, in public heartedness, in public holidays, in public housing, in public images, in public intellectuals, in public interests, in public languages, in public lavatories, in public lectures, in public libraries, in public life, in public mindedness, in public monuments, in public noises, in public notaries, in public offerings, in public offices, in public opinions, in public orators, in public ownership, in public parks, in public policies, in public prosecutors, public radio, and public readers. Thank you.